السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله
أشهد أن لا
أشهد أن محمدا أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله
أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله
حي على الصلاة
لا حول ولا قوة
حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وإنما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى وما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين
Ramadan is gone and Shawwal is getting close to the end as well. And the shayateens that were under siege in Ramadan are all back again to try over and over with the son of Adam, with the main goal is to make him ungrateful and to deviate him from the straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to be ready for the shaitan and try to defeat him all the way. Make him fail in all his attempts to deviate us from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to do that, let's start by defining what is the straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have described it. يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام في حديث رواه عبد الله بن مسعود that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم have came and drew a line on the ground, and from this line he drew side lines to the left and right from this line, and then he started to describe this is the straight path of Allah. And these lines to the sides are deviating from the straight path of Allah. And on each one of those, there is shaitan calling those who are on the straight path to deviate and take one of these side paths. A shaitan that will be calling you to commit the haram in the different forms of the haram in one of these side paths. And it has different forms and different positions. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is describing the straight path of Allah, saying that the straight path of Allah, there is a straight path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving an example with. ضرب الله مثلا صراطا مستقيما. And this path has on its side two fences. And in these fences there are open doors. And above these doors there are curtains hanging. And at the beginning of the sirat, of this path, there is a caller calling the people to get into the path. And on top of the path, there is a caller that whenever someone tries to go into one of the doors in the fences, he will remind him, don't go through the door. As if you go into it, it will be hard to go back. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is describing this image. And he's saying that this path is al-Islam. And the fences are the boundaries of the Islam. And the doors that you have in these fences are the forbiddens of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the caller in the beginning of this surat or this path is a Quran telling the people to get into the surat, get into the path. And the caller on the top of the surat is a conscious that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had in each and every one of us to remind him. Whenever he wants to go into one of these doors, remind him that this is a haram. And if you go through the door, it will be hard to go back. In the third hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith rawah Nu'man ibn Bashir, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying الحلال بين والحرام بين، وبينهما أمور مشتبهات لا يعلمها كثير من الناس، فمن اتقى الشبهات فقد استبرأ لعرضه ودينه، ومن وقع في الشبهات فقد وقع في الحرام. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying that the halal is clear and the haram is clear. And between them there are some doubtful matters. Those who are trying to stay away from the doubtful matters, they have protected their religion and their honor. And those who fall into these doubtful matters, these doubtful matters are not known for most of the people, only the knowledgeable one knows about them. Those who fall into the doubtful matters, they will fall into haram if they don't have the knowledge. So the halal is clear and the haram is clear. And the doubtful matters are a lot between these. If you don't have the knowledge, stay away from them. Or ask those who have the knowledge about these doubtful matters. Or else you will fall in the haram, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have described. So these are three hadiths describing the straight path of Allah, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is describing it. Knowing that the shaitan is always there, either calling you on the sides of the path or making the doubtful matters as if it's halal for you, so that you can try and go and take the easy way without verifying, and so fall into the haram. On this path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have three kinds of enemies. The first enemy is your own self. إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. It will, your own self, he will call you for evil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in Surah Al-Shams, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have created your nafs, has the two sides, the good and the evil. The winners are the one who train their nafs on the good things and stay away from the evil. And the losers are the ones who are abandon their nafs, leaving it to commit the haram and fall into the evil. The second enemy is shayateen al-ins, the shayateen of the human beings. Those are the ones who are always calling for evil. They are falling into evil themselves and trying to call those who are on the straight path of Allah to join them. And those are very hard to deal with because they are present in front of you. They have the same form of the son of Adam. It's easy to get affected with. And for those, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning آيات in the Quran to deal with them. We also mentioned three of them. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة الأعراف خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله إنه سميع عليم. In dealing with شياطين الإنس, be forgiving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordering the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be forgiving and to take by the habits of the people. If there is certain urf that is going among a certain people, as far as it's not haram, go with it. And stay away from the ignorant ones. And if the shaitan poke you, seek Allah's refuge from the shaitan, as he is all hearing, all knowing. Be forgiving. Whoever did something to you, be forgiving. There is nothing to will happen to any of the son of Adam will be equivalent to what happened with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from his people. They have killed his uncle, and they have sanctioned at Bani Talib, and they have everything deprived from them. And they have tortured him in different ways. And he has been forgiving. Even those who has been left at the time of Fath Makkah, he has been forgiving. So whatever happened with you, learn from our role model, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and be forgiving. This is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. The second ayah, يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة المؤمنون ادفع بالتي هي أحسن السيئة نحن أعلم بما يصفون وقل ربي أعوذ بك من همزات الشياطين. Whatever happens to you from bad, push it back with good. Push it back with good. This is Allah's order. How to deal with something happened to you that's bad? Push it back with good. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying again in Surah Fussilat. وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ ادفع بالتي هي أحسن السيئة فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم. Push back the bad with good. So the one who is your enemy will be turning to be your friend. By what? By pushing bad back the bad with good. And it's not easy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that it requires patience. But those who really achieve it, وَمَا يُلَقَّى إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا. But those who really achieve it, they are getting a great reward. وَمَا يُلَقَّى إِلَّا ذُو حَظٍ عَظِيمٍ. So this is how to deal with the bad that happened to you from the son of Adam. Now, come to the third enemy that we want to mostly talk about today. Shayateen al-Jinn or Iblis. Imam ibn al-Qayyim was saying that there is no deed that Bani Adam is doing, but it will have one poke from the shaytan. Imma bi-ifrat wa imma bi-tafreet. Either you will exceed in your deed, so you will do more and above what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and fall into bid'ah wal a'yadu billah. You are adding to the religion, innovating in the religion, or with tafreet, you have shortage in what you are, your commitment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you fall into the sin wal a'yadu billah. So the shaitan will try in both directions, either for you to add more or to decrease in your commitment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Listen to قول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة النحل فإذا قرأت القرآن فاستعذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنه ليس له سلطان على الذين آمنوا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون إنما سلطانه على الذين يتولونه والذين هم به مشركون. If you are poked with the shaitan, seek Allah's refuge from the shaitan, as the shaitan has no power on those who are real and true believers. His power is only on those who are weak in their belief. So seek Allah's refuge whenever you are falling into one of the traps of the shaitan. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة الأعراف فبما أغويتني لأقعدن لهم صراطك المستقيم ثم لآتينهم من بين أيديهم ومن خلفهم وعن أيمانهم وعن شمائلهم ولا تجد أكثرهم شاكرين. This is the promise of the shaitan to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will do with Bani Adam until the day of judgment, that he will be for them on the straight path, from the right, from the front, from the back, from the right side, from the left side, so that he will make Bani Adam ungrateful. He made this promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time when he was expelled from Jannah, because he didn't prostrate for Bani Adam because of the arrogance. So he made the promise. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a chance until the day of judgment, he will be there for on the straight path, trying to get the Bani Adam out of the path. By what? By making them ungrateful. And when you are ungrateful, you have shortage in your commitment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have shortage in your ibadat. You have shortage in everything that you commit with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you don't feel the bounties of Allah. So beware of what the shaitan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, had made it as an enemy for us. Beware for the shaitan and what he wants to do for you. He will try in all directions. And we'll go now through some of the things that the shaitan will try in sequence. He will try to get anything from you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, one day Sayyida Safiya was with him in the masjid, and after they finished, he went with her to her door, so that he will just, it was at night, so just take her to her door. And then a couple of Muslims were passing by. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam called them and told them, "This is my wife Safiya." Just to make sure that they have no doubt about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's trying to clear the doubt, even though they didn't sound anything. So they were surprised. "What are you talking about, O Prophet of Allah? How can we have any doubt about you?" He said, "I'm just trying to clear the doubt, as the shaitan is running in the veins of Bani Adam like the blood." Imam al-Shafi'i was saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this point was trying to protect them from falling into kufr by doubting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was not trying to defend himself, he was afraid about them to doubt the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is a lesson for us. Don't say, "I didn't do anything wrong, I'm okay, I don't need to clear anything." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving us an example. If there is anything that can be clarified, do it. As clear the doubt. As the shaitan might whisper to your brothers or to whoever is, might doubt about you, and you will fall into this. Clear the doubt as much as you can, and learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now let's go through the entries of the shaitan. What will the shaitan try with us in sequence? First of all, he will try with you to commit shirk. Wal'ayadu billah. As you know the story of Barasisa. He was someone who was committed with Allah, abid to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all his life. Doesn't leave his sawma'. And the shaitan was trying a lot with him. Over and over and over to get him away to do the shirk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he couldn't. Until one of the shayateen came, shaitan called shaitan al-abyad, and came and said, I will take Barasisa out of, will commit shirk. He went, he had some people from the same village, they wanted to go to war, they left, they wanted to leave their sister with someone whom they can trust, and they couldn't find anyone more trustable than Barasisa. The shaitan whispered for them for that. They went, they asked him, he refused over and over. They told him, "We're going to put her in this place away from you. Just provide her with food and keep, I mean, if she needs anything, she just can ask you." At the end, he agreed. And then, after a long time, the shaitan whispered to him, "What are you afraid of? You are the great worshipper, Barasisa. Just go check on her. Check from far if she is good or not." And after a lot of trials, just from far, and trusting himself, he will not fall into haram. Started with a haram look, looking into her from far, with an intention that he's just checking it, she is good. And then trying, just check on her, have a word with her, just check if she's okay. And then develops until he sits with her and then committed adultery with her. See how the shaitan takes long time between each stage, long time. And this is what the shaitan will try with you. If you are very strong, he will try something small to deviate, and then will leave you long time, and then small, and then long time, and then small, until he reach his goal. So the long story short, he have committed adultery, and then he has to kill the woman and the baby that was in her belly, and then the brothers knew, and then he was about to be crucified for what he did. The shaitan came to him and told him, if you commit the shirk now, I will save you from this. And in this situation he did. And this is what was mentioned in Surah Al-Hashr. Shaitan, when he told the insan, it's called insan ukfur falamma kafar qala inni bari'un mink inni akhafu Allah rabbil alamin. He asked him to commit shirk, and when he did, he said, I'm free of you, I have nothing to do with you, as I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first thing that shaitan will try with you, try for you to commit shirk. And you know, there is big shirk that you have worshipping someone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there are different kind of shirk that you commit all the way. When you try to, there is shirk al-asghar that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have warned us from. To do something supposedly for the sake of Allah, and you have someone else watching you. Your intention have something associating something with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are doing the salah, and when someone is watching you, you're doing it better. You are reading the Quran, and when someone is watching you, you're reading it better. You do more when someone is seeing. When you're by yourself, you're lazy. The Prophet ﷺ was saying, Abu Bakr, الشرك فيكم أصغر من دبيب النملة على الصخرة الصماء في الليلة الظلماء. That the association with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your hearts is smaller than the footsteps in the dark night on the hard rock. How can you feel that? So and this is now the big range, from this small to that big. And the shaitan will try all the way. The second entry for the shaitan is bid'ah. When he tried to push you to innovate in the religion. And this is the most beloved to the shaitan after the shirk. Because it's something that's happening in the religion. When you commit a sin, you know that it's a sin, and you will go back and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fix whatever you did. But when you are doing the bid'ah, knowing that you are trying to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't do, now you are adding to the religion. The shaitan will love that. And he is utilizing the ignorance of the people about the religion in order to grow that bigger and bigger. And it spreads very fast. You find someone who looks good, he looks righteous, and he's doing something that you never knew about before. He must know about it better than me. I'll just follow without trying to verify. So the bid'ah is the most beloved, one of the most beloved things of the shaitan after shirk. Because it spreads fast, utilizing the ignorance of the people and adding to the religion the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have brought to us, and supposedly to be complete. Then the shaitan will try to get you from the major sins. Committing zina, wal-ayyazu billah, committing riba, the interest, and having the sihr. These are some of those. Qasf al-muhsanat. The different major sins. And then he will try with you to commit minor sins if he failed with the major ones. Minor sins can be very small. You feel it's small and it's not really that big. It will not count. But imagine that the big fire is broken based on very small pieces of wood. Some of the ulama is saying that the minor sins are minor until the one who's doing them is persistent in doing it. So you know it's a minor sin, and you continue to do it over and over and over. So the minor sin is by itself is minor, but the consistency in doing it now became a major sin. And then he failed with you to commit the minor sin, he will now continue into your ibadat and making you do less ibadat. You are committed to doing the salah and the Quran and the qiyam and the siyam and everything. He will try with you his best to listen that. And if he failed to listen that, he will work on your intention in doing that. As we said, the shirk al-azghar, your intention, he will try his best to corrupt this intention. So it's not purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're doing the sadaqah, so the people will see. You will say, this is a generous person. So beware of the shaitan and the different things that the shaitan will try with you in sequence. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفرونه الغفور الرحيم. So how can we deal with the shaitan and the different ways the shaitan is trying to attack us? الحرز من الشيطان. The first thing is الاستغفار. يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام في حديث رواه أبو سعيد الخدري أن الشيطان قال: وعزتك يا رب لا أبرح أغوي عبادك ما دامت أرواحهم في أجسادهم. فقال الرب: وعزتي وجلالي لا أزال أغفر لهم ما استغفرون. The shaitan is promising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will try to seduce the son of Adam as far as their souls are in their bodies. And the Prophet and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is responding that by my glory I will keep forgiving them as far as they ask forgiveness. So keep asking forgiveness. Whenever you fall into the traps of the shaitan, keep asking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and never, never give up that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive. And this is by itself is a sin. Ask Allah forgiveness knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive. The second is al-ista'adha. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة الأعراف: وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. If you are poked by the shaitan, seek Allah's refuge from the shaitan. You are seeking Allah's help to have you have victory over the shaitan. The third is المعوذتين. يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام لعقبة بن عامر الجهني: تعوذ بهما فما تعوذ بمثلهما. قل أعوذ برب الفلق وقل أعوذ برب الناس. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is advising his Sahaba to make استعاذة من الشيطان and from the jinn by these two. قل أعوذ برب الفلق وقل أعوذ برب الناس. آية الكرسي. In a hadith that was narrated by Abu Huraira that the shaitan came in a form of a human and was trying to get from Mal of his zakah, and he's doing it in a night. So he told him, Abu Hurairah told him, I'll take you to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he told him, leave me and I'll not do it again. And he came again the next night. I told him, leave me and I'll not do it again. And the third night when he came, he told him, there is no way I'm gonna take you to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He told him, leave me and I will advise you with something that will be protection for you for the rest of your life. He said, what is that? He said, read Ayat al-Kursi every night before you go to sleep. This will be a protection for you for in this night from the shaitan. So Abu Hurairah went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the next day and told him about this. He told him, صَدَقَكَ وَهُوَ كَذُوب. He has told you the truth even though he is a liar. This is the shaitan. And he advised you of something right. If you read Ayat al-Kursi every night before you go to sleep, it will be a protection for you through the night from the shaitan. ذكر الله. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في سورة القرآن في سورة الإسراء: وإذا قرأت القرآن جعلنا بينك وبين الذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة حجابا مستورا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in Surah al-Isra, and when you read the Quran, It will be a barrier. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a barrier between you and those who are not believers of the hereafter. From shayateen al-ins wal-jinn. أواخر سورة البقرة يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام من قرأ بالآيتين من آخر البقرة في ليلة كفتاه. The last two ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying, those who read this, the last two verses from Surah Al-Baqarah in a night, it will be a protection for him. And then to be always on wudu and to increase in your salah and to increase in the salah of the salah on the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And to always try to keep yourself in jama'ah when you're trying to do something. Especially when you're trying to do something that's righteous and good. Jama'ah, the shaitan has very weak power above them. But when you are alone, it's easier. When you try to, for example, memorize the Quran by yourself, you try to go and then you find yourself or your determination become weaker. And then you try again and then determination become weaker. But when you are in jama'ah, everyone is supporting each other. When someone falls, the others will try to pull him. So these are some of the entries of the shaitan so that we can be ready for them. And some of the things that we need to do in order to protect ourselves from falling into the traps of the shaitan. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفرونا والغفور رحيم اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واقض عنا شر ما قضيت إنك تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك إنه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت تباركت ربنا وتعاليت فلك الحمد على ما قضيت ولك الشكر على ما أعطيت نستغفرك اللهم من جميع الذنوب والخطايا ونتوب إليك اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا وانصرنا على من عادانا اللهم لا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا واجعل الجنة هي ظهرنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين واخذل من خذل الدين اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل بقاع الأرض يا رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وأقم الصلاة